Good morning, and thank you for coming along today. And for those who are on the video streaming, this is a new trial for us to communicate with people in the field in an effective and efficient way. I'm here at Fiskville today, and we want to give you a briefing on the current state of play with a number of important changes which are occurring within CFA. I think at the outset, I'd like to welcome you all and thank you for your time. We're going to have a number of presentations, first of all from the Acting CEO, Michael Wootton. Then I'll move into a presentation which is probably going to focus more on the field implementation and the current phase we're in. That might take some time. We want to go into a fair bit of detail. And then we'll pause around about 10 to 11. And the intent of that pause will be to take on board questions from the field. I understand with the notification of this webinar that there's a link that you can ask questions online. We'll then analyse those questions and then come back at around about 11 o'clock so that we can give an online response to those questions. I guess at the outset, we may not be able to answer all those questions, but at least we're starting a process of dialogue to address those questions that you have. So without any further ado, I'd call on Michael Wootton, who is the Acting Chief Executive Officer, just to say a few words. Thank you, Michael.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Ewan, and thank you to everybody for joining us. My purpose really today, as Ewan indicated, is to give a general overview of where we are in the organisational change program and talk a little bit in detail about where some of the different teams have reached in terms of their consultation. And then Ewan will go into a fair bit more detail around fire and emergency management. It seems that Creating Our Future Together and COFT have been going on forever. The organisational change process actually started in 2011. And I suppose it's important just to remind people that Creating Our Future Together is more than just a change of organisational structure. It's about looking at our business processes, our systems, our operating models, who our customers are, what are the services that we deliver? So structure is part of that, but there are a number of other elements to the change program. It's important to understand from the CFA board's point of view that they certainly hold the Chief Executive Officer accountable for delivery of the Creating Our Future Together program. And Mick, although he's on leave, clearly is the leader of the process and the leader of the organisation. And he relies on his executive leadership team to support him in the delivery of that program. And Ewan and I are obviously key parts of that executive leadership team along with our other executive director colleagues. The reason for change is about making sure that CFA is as agile and efficient and adaptable as possible. Our goal is to create designs which enable our frontline people to focus on delivering services to the Victorian community. Our support services have undertaken a co-design process, and I'll talk a little bit about where they're at with those. And they've given members the opportunity to share some of their ideas, and that's a process that's still ongoing. ELT's also undertaken a harmonisation process to look at each of the designs and make sure they actually fit together. And that also is part of that consultation process, and things can't be finalised until those two elements have been concluded. When we started the change process, there were key 11 principles of COFT that we had to take into consideration and we agreed would guide us. And I won't go through all those today, but there's a couple I think that are really important and we just need to remind ourselves of. The allocation of resources is to be determined on a risk and needs basis. Where possible, resources will be mobile and boundaryless. So there we're talking about having people where we need them to deliver services to the community, to our members, to our volunteers, to our brigades. And that resources will be aligned to allocation of responsibility and accountability. As I said, we're in a process of consultation for many of the designs. Others are due to start. And I think it's important just to talk a little bit about what consultation is. It's about providing people with the opportunity to ask questions and provide feedback about proposed designs and structure prior to final decisions being taken. Support services teams are already engaged in that process, talking to staff, talking to our volunteers and members. And for those support services to work and for central coordination to work, which is what is proposed in some cases, we need to have conversations about that now, but also on an ongoing basis to make sure that what we propose and finalise actually works as we move forward. In terms of consultation and where we are, the people and culture team have been consulting, and their consultation formally closed yesterday. So what happens with that one now is that Fran Boyd and her team will take on board the feedback and suggestions they've received prior to coming up with a finalised design. The performance and strategy team's consultation closes towards the end of next week or the beginning of the week after. In business services, my own team, some changes have already been made and been consulted upon, so the changes to asset maintenance coordinators and the protective equipment team reporting to technical asset services have been consulted, concluded and implemented, and business services consultation is occurring now in relation to most other parts of that team and will close in October. And the operational training and volunteerism and communities and communications teams will commence their consultation next week. And probably people would be aware that some of the proposals in there are around embedding certain services in OT and V. And clearly Lex DeMann, as the exec director of that team, is leading that consultation process on that proposed design. Some of the key design features that we're looking at in terms of our consultation, we're talking about resources being mobile and not defined by artificial boundaries. I alluded to that earlier. Over time, we expect that brigades will see advantages in flexibility of service delivery, increased expertise and knowledge from specialist resources, and much greater service at the front line, so focusing very much on district. There will be different solutions for different services, so we're not locked into a particular mode of service delivery for our support services. They'll be delivered in a range of ways. We're looking to make those services known and easy for members to access by using technology, by phone, by face-to-face means. There'll be a focus on developing self-service facilities, which will increase accessibility and empower members. You know, in many places, self-service now is considered better practice. We use it every day in our daily lives, online banking, online shopping, apps, those sort of things. So we need to take advantage both of that flexibility, but of the fact that the many, many more people in the community use those channels today. When consultation closes, leadership teams will consider and work through the feedback, the thoughts and the suggestions and finalise designs. So that'll happen over the next month or two. And then we'll start to think about what does transition look like. And it'll be about transitioning people to new ways of working, including the matching process between people and roles. We plan to progressively implement the proposed changes to ensure we get the model right and to minimise disruption to our core business. So we're in October, we're heading into a fire season. Obviously, our critical core business needs to be at the forefront of our thinking, but we can also do some design work in the background while that occurs. For support services teams in particular, we expect to be well advanced by the end of the calendar year, December 2014. But we do realise that's a tight timeline, but we're still working towards that date. We expect the initial process of transitioning people and processes to the new way of working will take some time to implement. So we're not talking here about turning a tap off or turning a new tap on. There's a lot of work to occur, and it'll be done progressively and with our people. And finally, all our employees will have meaningful work to do, and that's a key element people need to bear in mind. So that covers the brief information that I wanted to provide, and I'll hand back to you and now, and then we'll hopefully enjoy some questions later on in the presentation. Thanks, Ewan.
Thank you, Michael. And again, just to reinforce, this is a trial of a new form of communication. Certainly I, as Chief Officer, and the executive team have, both from our individual travels, but also from some of the feedback we've had from the culture survey, have taken on board that there is a need for a more comprehensive and systematic way of communicating to the field. So this is an experiment, and we'd be interested in your feedback as to how well this type of communication occurs. But from our point of view, we see that there may be a need for the next 2 or 3 months to have a similar communication, perhaps a little bit shorter, every couple of weeks. I guess I just want to also reflect on some feedback we've had about, you know, why is this taking so long, and also probably some feedback about why is fire and emergency management seeming to be a little bit slower than other directorates. We need to reflect on the fact that we had a really busy fire season, probably one of the more challenging fire seasons that we've had since Black Saturday. And it was characterised by the Hazelwood Mine fire that started on the 9th of February that consumed a significant number of resources, both during the fire and immediately afterwards. We've recently seen the Hazelwood Mine Fire Board of Inquiry report back, and one of the quotes that came out of that was that CFA members went above and beyond what was expected of them. So CFA and the fire agencies were treated very well in the analysis by the Hazelwood Mine Board of Inquiry, and I think that's a real credit to us. But in doing so, that set fire emergency management and other parts of the organisation behind our schedule for creating our future together. So I don't want to make any apology for that. As Michael has said, provision of our frontline service delivery, enacting our mission of protecting lives and property comes first at all times, but it has set our time frame back more than what we would have liked. So the purpose today is to do a couple of things. The first is to acknowledge that from today, the 2nd of October, we are now moving from 8 Fair Victoria regions to the new 5-region model that has been articulated over the last few months. We also want to formally welcome and introduce Assistant Chief Officers as being the most senior CFA person in each of those 5 regions. We want to introduce the Regional Integration and Transition Program, which for Fire and Emergency Management is the next phase of creating our future together. I want to acknowledge the uncertainty which is out there, and I want to also, as Michael has done, reaffirm that we are firmly focused on delivering our frontline services and in particular preparing for the forthcoming fire season, which looks as though it might be coming on a little bit earlier. So I'm going to run through those things in a little bit more detail now. The first is to acknowledge that today is the start of a new era and the end of a former era as we move into the new 5-region model. The 5 Assistant Chief Officers who have been recruited, selected, they actually commenced an induction program about 3 weeks ago. They commence today and they are the most senior CFA person in the 5 regions. They are also the most senior operational representative out in the field within their region. And they perform a quite different role to the regional directors. They'll be active and visible leaders. They will assume control, an overarching control of our response activities. They'll also be accountable for our service delivery within the regions. And they may also pick up responsibility for a number of corporate priorities in our corporate plan. Today also marks the commencement of a new fire and emergency management leadership team. So the Chief Officer, the Deputy Chief Officers, Executive Manager, Community Capability, my Officer, the Chief Officer, and the 5 ACOs will form the fire and emergency management leadership team. And this will link me as Chief Officer through the Deputy Chiefs and Headquarters more directly to the field and provide a clear chain of command where previously it wasn't clear through the regional commanders and the regional directors. I want to make it clear that the role of the Assistant Chief Officer is a new role. It's different to the previous regional director role. But it would be appropriate just to pause here and pay tribute to the regional directors over the years and the former arrangements, and to acknowledge the critical role that regions and regional directors and the former regional teams have played in delivering a wide range of programs to the community for and on behalf of CFA. And I'd like to take this moment to acknowledge that very significant role, to thank you, to recognise and express our gratitude for the way in which people have approached that role, but also acknowledge that we are now saying goodbye to a particular era in CFA and moving into a new era. I'd like to reinforce the need for change. Why are we doing this? Essentially, we're moving into a new implementation phase that recognises that we've got to do our business differently into the future because of a number of external factors and environmental factors. I guess the first is that government and the community are changing in their expectations of CFA and the emergency management sector. I guess one example of that is that in the last couple of years we've seen the introduction of a fire services levy, and whilst you might not think that's changed a lot, it has certainly changed the expectations in government in how we deliver services and how we are able to demonstrate value for money and public value. We're also moving into a new era where the minister and the government are saying that no longer is it acceptable that emergency services duplicate service delivery. No longer is it acceptable that each emergency service does the same thing independently. They're wanting emergency services to be joined up, to be effective, to be efficient, with no overlap and no gaps between the agencies. They're expecting a cooperative approach, multi-agencies working together, interoperability, and us working together in a multi-hazard environment. And Craig Lapsley, the Emergency Management Commissioner, and the State Control Team reinforce that in what we do, which is protecting the community, we work as one. But importantly, we want to extend that ethos of working as one from not just applying to our frontline service delivery, but our broader service delivery and also our support to our frontline people. We've seen over the last couple of months some significant changes in the emergency management sector with the formation of Emergency Management Victoria, the appointment of Craig as the Emergency Management Commissioner, and Neil Robertson as the Chief Executive of Emergency Management Victoria. EMV are appointing a new executive structure that will make it clearer as to what their role is and what the emergency services role is, and we welcome this new era and we go forward confident that we can deliver a greater accountability to both the minister and to the public. We also operate in uncertain times, and one of the greatest uncertainties is about future revenues coming into government. Government quite rightly are saying that we provide money to agencies such as CFA for specific projects. We expect those projects to be implemented on time and within budget and delivering on the core expectations of government for that funding. They are expecting a return on their investment in the fire services, and they are expecting maintenance of public value. We also operate in an environment where changes in the geopolitical environment, severe weather, and as we've recently seen, changes in the security environment are driving us in a particular direction that we need to respond to. CFA and Victoria are not alone in these challenges. We're seeing changes occurring in other government departments, and we work very closely, for example, with the Department of Environment and Primary Industries. And they are also making changes at a corporate level, at a service delivery level, and out in the field. But we're also seeing changes occurring in the structure of fire and emergency service delivery within Australia and overseas. And just to quote a couple of examples, there are significant changes have occurred recently in Queensland and in WA. We're seeing more change foreshadowed in South Australia and also in some of our sister services in other states. when we look overseas in Canada, the United States, the United Kingdom, parts of Europe, we also see examples of significant change in service delivery. So we are not alone in moving to a more agile, accountable, effective and efficient framework for service delivery. We're proud of CFA today and what we are, but in being proud of where we are and recognising the history of the organisation, it's important that we shouldn't be complacent. We do need to move forward with the times, and we must look ahead and shape ourselves, as Michael said, so that we can be agile and responsive to the needs of the community and also to our volunteers, our frontline career staff and our members generally. We must strive to be sustainable, effective, efficient and to create real public value and to introduce an ethos of continuous improvement. And it's in that vein that we move to this new phase, which is the Regional Integration and Transition Program. This next phase will be formed to implement Fire and Emergency Management's changes, both centrally in headquarters and to those who provide support services, and also out in the fields. It's important that, as Michael has outlined, we recognise that changes in Fire and Emergency Management aren't done alone. And again, one of the reasons why Fire and Emergency Management is at the stage we're at the moment is that it was important that some of the support service directorates clarified the way in which they intended to deliver those support services out into the field before Fire and Emergency Management started shaping our new structure and our proposals for the future. I want to reinforce CFA's support to our volunteers, to our career staff, to our brigades, our staff in fire stations, to our groups, and along with our service delivery to the Victorian community. That will continue to remain our focus during this next journey and phase of change. And that might mean that there are periods when the change journey is interrupted and goes more slowly. And it's important that we recognise at the outset that the timeframes for our implementation and even our consultation may be extended because of our operational environment. There are four main themes to the Regional Integration and Transition Program. The first is integrating and moving from the eight Fair Victoria regions to the new five regions that CFA has articulated. Today signals the start of those new five regions, but necessarily there'll be a suite of processes and systems that now need to change to implement that, that decision. Secondly, to operationalise the embedded model of support service delivery into the regions and districts. And as Michael has articulated, we're at different stages with some of those support service arrangements. Many are at the consultation phase. When consultation has been completed, that needs to come back to the executive team to endorse that model, which would then be implemented. The third main theme here is to implement the new business planning and operating model into regions and districts, and that includes moving to some new structures in those locations. And the fourth theme is supporting future changes which we need to make at a regional and district level. So again, I want to reinforce that the phase we're in the Regional Integration and Transition Program isn't going to be achieved overnight. To coin a phrase, we're talking about an evolutionary change, not a revolutionary change. I also want to reinforce that we're not proposing that there be people losing their positions out of this. There might be changes to jobs and job descriptions. There are likely to be changes in reporting relationships and structures that will be undertaken after consultation and taking on board your thoughts, advice and concerns. You might not recognise it, but much of this change and the seeds for this change has already been sown. And the Regional Integration and Transition Program is one new phase of a broader change which has been approached in CFA. And some examples I can give you of change which is already well on the way to implementation is the new Brigade Member and Classification Project. We've also seen the Brigade Sustainability Pilot Program, which is another example of providing support in a different way to our brigades and in particular our volunteer members. The Command and Control and the Role of the Group Program, which has been going now for about 3 years, and shortly there'll be a publication issued on local command and control, which again is an important definition of the role of the group and local command and control in CFA and how that relates to the line of control in the state bushfire control arrangements. Through the work of people like John Haynes and Meg Lowe, we've seen the development of a service delivery model, and through the CFA board, who have established a service delivery committee, we are working on the development of a service delivery strategy. That's an important bit of work which will take a bit of work we did about 6 months ago on the Chief Officer's capability and priority statement, bring that into the broader CFA strategic planning model. As identified in the service delivery model, Fire and Emergency Management's future structure will be underpinned by a number of things that we currently know. And the first is brigades and groups will continue to be the core structure for delivering frontline emergency services. It's also the front line for community capability building activities based on risk and partnering with the communities. And I want to recognise the tremendous work that our communities and communications team and our community capability teams have been doing over the last 3 or 4 years. And that's been no better exemplified than the annual community engagement forum, which has grown from 4 years ago, I think around about 80 brigades, to the most recent forum earlier this year, where we saw over 400 brigades were represented at this year's forum. So that's the brigade and group level. The districts, and I want to again reaffirm that we have continued with essentially the same number of districts that we've had historically. The exception there is that the government have recently announced the formation of a new district in and around the city of La Trobe, which we're calling District 27. That will be a new project that we're starting work on. But the role of the district will be to lead, manage and support CFA members through brigades, groups, fire stations to ensure effective service delivery to our communities and in turn turning the emergency management policy and our business plans into action on the ground. So it's a critical role in linking our planning to actions on the ground. At the regional level, we see the regions will focus on strategic leadership, management oversight, and in particular oversight of the implementation of the CFA strategic plan and the Fire and Emergency Management Service Delivery Strategy. As I said, that's in process at the moment, but we see one of the key accountabilities of the Assistant Chief Officers will be implementing the CFA corporate plan and that service delivery strategy. They will also coordinate and enable service delivery from the districts to provide regional command and to, with our emergency management partners, support the line of control at regional level. And then at a state level, the role again is strategic leadership at a state level, governance of CFA service delivery, oversight and implementation again of the CFA business plan, which includes a number of new initiatives and business as usual activities, to lead, inform and partner in the emergency management sector. And I'd have to say that with the emergence of Emergency Management Victoria, a significant proportion of my time and my deputy's time and the executive time is being spent in interfacing and dealing with that that emergency management sector. Also, in exercising state command through the deputy chief officers and exercising statewide command and control through the line of control and the state control centre. So again, to reinforce our structure, service delivery at the brigade, group and fire station level, the districts lead and manage support for our frontline people. Regional level is to provide oversight of the implementation of our plans and governance, regional command, and at state level, strategic leadership, governance and interoperability with the emergency management sector. A really important change that we want to reinforce is the role of the regional at the district operations manager. The district operations manager has always been the OIC of the district, but we've seen that had been watering down that role over the last couple of years. So I want to reinforce that the district operations manager is the officer in charge of the district, and CFA service delivery to the field and support services being provided to our people in the field will be delivered either through or by the district operations manager. So I just want to reinforce the importance of that role and thank the operations managers for the role that they've always provided, but thank them for stepping up to the plate as we've seen in the last few months. The district operations manager will be accountable for managing and supervising district resources, including the budget, for service delivery within their district and supporting their brigades and groups in the discharge of the mission of CFA. In our consultation with you, we'll be proposing that districts will have a consistent resource allocation model. So there'll be a base model that each district would have in terms of the structure and the functions and roles, but we're saying that the base model may change and is scalable from one district to another depending on the risk and needs within the district. And that's part of the consultation process which will come from here on, that we'll be negotiating with district and regional assistant chief officers about what level of resources will be required in each district. Embedded resources are providing support services through groups, brigades and members, and will work through either the district operations manager or the operations officer responsible for that catchment. So again, I want to reinforce the importance of those support services which flow on to our frontline members is done through the operations manager or the operations officer. I guess we'll know when we're successful when we look at ourselves and we tick the box and say we are capable, competent, and we're committed. We feel empowered, valued, and unified. The community is saying, and the government is saying, that we're trusted and respected, and that we can assure ourselves independently and from our own analysis that we're providing sustainable, performance-focused services to the community. And also that we're positioning ourselves and our systems of work so that we're agile, can anticipate and react to change as we see occur from time to time. In moving forward, I want to acknowledge that, like any change, there is uncertainty about the future. Many of you will have questions about what it means for you as an individual employee of CFA. I do appreciate that this is a frustrating time for you. I know that you are wanting to know why it's taking so long and you're wanting us to just get on with it. I acknowledge that it's causing many of you anxiety and that you want to have certainty and implement this change as rapidly as possible. But in doing so, it's important that we move to a new structure and new arrangements in concert with the representative bodies, that we consult with you and take on board your ideas and that we get it right. We don't want to revisit this change. We want to get it right and make sure that as we implement change, it doesn't risk our service delivery to the field and doesn't risk our preparedness for the summer. But we do this once and we do it well. So that means that we'll be continuing to do this in a cautious and careful manner. There will be changes which affect you and I and fire and emergency management people. And there will be also changes across CFA. And so I want to say in moving forward, there will continue to be some level of uncertainty amongst staff. As I said earlier on, we have also taken on board the need for more regular and more direct communication. We're a large and complex organisation. We're hoping that this style of communication will be the start of similar video casts and podcasts that we can offer you to improve that direct communication. I appreciate that many other directorates have already started their briefing process, but also want to appreciate that fire and emergency management is a large part of CFA. We're well distributed across the whole of Victoria, and it's a difficult part of the organisation to get a message out to quickly and efficiently. So I'm hoping that this methodology will be successful. Some members will learn that their reporting line and their current position may change with aligning to the new supporting arrangements through other directorates. You'll be learning that through the consultation process, and you'll be learning that when, at the completion of the consultation process, Mick and the executive team make decisions to then implement those changes. Regardless of which directorate is involved, you may find yourself staying within fire and emergency management or transitioning to a new directorate. We want to reinforce that we act as one CFA, focused on our mission to serve the community and to protect lives and property. That should be a single, binding, unifying statement that we are all together focused on serving the community, focused on a mission protecting lives and property. And whether we're frontline deliverers of service to the community, or we're supporting that frontline, or we're further up the line of control or chain of command, or we're providing support services, what you do is important to CFA, and it's important in the achievement of that overall mission. Today, I hope that there'll be a number of questions, and I'm sure there will be, and we'll get back to those questions a little bit later on. We may not be able to answer all of those questions today. Those questions we can't answer, we'll take back, and we'll get back to you, perhaps in the next webinar, or certainly in hard copy. The change, again, will be a gradual process. I want to reinforce it's more going to be an evolution, not revolution. We are committed to engaging, consulting, and taking on feedback through that process. You'll notice over the next couple of months that we'll take account, as I've said before, of the fire season and our service delivery to the community. And again, it's really important that we don't lose sight on what the main thing is and what we're here for. Our priority will be focused on the upcoming fire season. And we've made very clear to the Assistant Chief Officers and shortly to the Operations Managers and to our Incident Management personnel that the focus must be on preparedness and readiness for the fire season. As we speak, pre-season briefings are occurring throughout the state. That's not just for operational personnel, it's for our community safety teams, our CFA support staff who play important roles supporting our district emergency command centres, supporting our brigades and groups, and supporting our incident management teams. It's also important that we recognise that there are a number of classes of CFA people who are on short-term contracts, and we are acutely aware of this. We have had some recent analysis done, and some figures that the acting CEO and I with some of the change team have been analysing over the last 24 hours. And can I just say that there are a number of projects which continue to make our employment arrangements for some people quite complex. And we're seeing some people acting into roles, and then that creates a vacancy, and other people act into their role, and other people act into that role. And we sometimes see, because of one person taking on a new role in a bushfires program or one of the new initiatives, that leads to up to five positions then cascading. And those positions are all on short-term contracts. We are also acutely aware that a number of those people are people we depend on for the fire season. We acknowledge the importance of that role. We're not able to make any definitive statement about that today, except to say that we are looking at trying to confirm those roles over the fire season, and we're analysing that detail, and ELT will be making decisions over the next couple of weeks. And those of you who are on fixed term contracts, we want to remove as much of that uncertainty as we possibly can. I want to reinforce that through the chain of command, your operations officer, operations manager, and the assistant chief officer, if you've got queries, then you shouldn't hesitate to raise the query with them. If they can't answer the question, then they'll pass it up and we'll attempt to address the question. I know I've said this, but we want to close by reinforcing that we are on the cusp of a new fire season. We saw on Sunday elevated temperatures and strong winds. We've seen a very much drier than average rainfall across much of the state over the last 12 months, and in particular over August and September. For many of us, the focus now needs to be on preparing for and responding to the fire season. I appreciate that there's a bit of a double-edged sword here, because in moving forward, we want to try and bring certainty and clarity on structure and process as quickly as we can. But I want to also acknowledge that in moving forward, there may be interruptions and delays because of the fire season. This is part of our business. It's just something that we need to acknowledge the criticality of the work that we do, and again reinforce that we will do the best we can to hasten this change, but our service delivery takes priority. I feel very fortunate to be the leader of a highly capable, highly committed team of people who deliver services to the Victorian community, critical services, 24 hours a day, 365 days of the year. We need to remain focused on our mission, and I want to remain steadfast in my appreciation for what you do for CFA and for the community. We as an organisation and with our emergency management partners do critical work in the community, and we see almost on a daily basis the life and death consequences of the work that we do. And on many occasions we don't read about it in the newspaper because of the very effective and efficient work that we do in preventing, in engaging with the community, minimising and mitigating risk, and suppressing and responding to emergencies as they occur. It is an exciting phase in CFA. We are moving forward. The Assistant Chief Officers are a key part of that new direction, and the change process reaches a particular chapter today, but it will continue on into the future. The establishment of regional change teams, which will be a critical element of moving forward at a regional level, will be very important to assist with the consultation process and to take on board your suggestions, region by region and district by district, about how we should shape ourselves and deliver our services into the future. I just want to close, if I may, on some reflection on some of the really important things which continue to occur within the organisation. We've recently seen the government announce some additional funding on planned burning, and that's a project that has been running, a pilot project, for the last couple of years. And the government has recognised that in a partnership with DEPI and saying that's such good work and they want to see it extended. Last night I had dinner with the Recruit Course 3 of 2014. We've currently got four and a bit recruit courses for 2014, and there's a both through the recruitment, the selection and the running of those recruit courses, really important in building our capability, meeting our obligations in Project 2016. Through Project 2016, we're seeing new fire station and staffing at Pakenham, at Ocean Grove. We're seeing new fire stations at Portland, South Morang, South Warrandyte and Warrnambool. And that project continues to mature. We're seeing great work with the Volunteer Support Program, in particular the Brigade Sustainability Pilot. The fire season briefings don't just happen, and that's a really important part of our sector leadership for the next fire season. The community capability team are formulating their targeted service delivery to the communities. We're seeing work commencing with the Victorian Farmers Federation and VFBV on the development of a voluntary grain harvesting code of practice. We're seeing specialist appliances in heavy hazmats, aerial pumpers, and MCVs being brought online and in service in a number of locations. We're seeing work occurring on the formation of District 27 in the Latrobe Valley, implementing the recommendations from the Hazelwood Board of Inquiry review. The regional radio dispatch system, which has been a major transformation of our radio communication, dispatch communications outside the metropolitan area. We're seeing prototype appliances being built up for medium pumpers, for heavy tankers, and also a BA van. And we continue to work with VFBV on introduction of a new uniform so that the whole of CFA has a consistent look. So that's just a snapshot of some of the really important work which continues on out there as we prepare for the fire season and we move forward in the regional integration and transition program. Thank you for being here today at Fiskville and for tuning in to this webinar. Very much appreciate your time, and we'll be back very soon. Thank you.